In 1964, the military came to power in Brazil. The dictatorship tolerated no opposition, and thousands disappeared in the hands of the military police. A veil of fear and silence fell over the memory of social movements that had risen in Brazil in the 50s and 60s. Violent suppression of social unrest was rewarded with foreign investments and international loans, and the Brazilian economy became the eighth largest in the world. It was called a third world economic miracle until the mid-1970s, when the national debt reached alarming proportions and inflation took off. Social movements, which had been crushed in the 1960s, revived in new forms, and the military government gradually allowed the return of democracy in the 1980s. In November 1988, we rented out our apartment in San Francisco, took leave from our jobs, and set out for Brazil with our four-year-old daughter and our home video camera. The country was emerging from nearly three decades of military rule. Now that people could once again talk openly, we wanted to find out about the grassroots movements that had sprung up all over the country. For 4 months, we wandered around this enormous country looking for these points of resistance, talking to people who refused to accept the rules of the game as defined by Brazil's elite.
Fazendo amizades, conquistando vitórias, em vez de ficar pelas esquinas cochichando, contando prosas. Em vez de ficar pelas esquinas cochichando, contando prosas. Quem cochicha, rabo espicha.
Our first stop was São Paulo, a city of 15 million, the cultural and industrial capital of the country. Millions of immigrants have poured into São Paulo from the impoverished countryside, lured by dreams of a better life. But most ended up in the slums and shanty towns of the periferia, the outskirts of the city, where infant mortality is among the highest on the planet. But with the spread of sophisticated television networks, even the poorest Brazilians can indulge in the fantasy world of consumer delights, American style.
Submarino sonar da estrela, você nunca vai enjoar.
Inflation was raging at 2,000% a year. In the prosperous city centers, those who could afford it rushed to spend their diminishing wealth in well-stocked supermarkets and El Dorado shopping malls, incongruously decorated with Christmas elves and snow in the middle of the hot Brazilian summer. But as we wandered the city streets, we could see that not everyone had bought the consumer dream. Elaborate graffiti made an ironic running commentary on the direction of modern mass culture in Brazil.
Eu como a cultura que me foi dada. Quer dizer, eu nasci.
I eat the culture that was given to me. I was born with opportunities to have culture and learn things, to understand society and people. So I swallow these things that I learned and then I spit them all up. I satisfy my physiological needs around here.
Fisiologicamente as minhas necessidades por aqui, por isso aqui. Então, quer dizer, isso é uma antropofagia.
That's anthropophagy. There used to be anthropophagists here in Brazil, Indians that ate people. The Portuguese were tasty, good to eat.
We met Zé, a painter involved with a group of artists who had taken their art to the streets in protest against the elitism of the galleries and museums. He took us on a tour of his group's 20th century cave paintings on neighborhood walls. They practice a kind of cultural cannibalism, sampling from an international menu of pop culture and drawing inspiration from the anthropophagist or cannibalist movement of the 1920s. The movement was founded by Brazilian modernists in celebration of the Tupi Indians, real cannibals encountered by the original Portuguese colonists. Anthropophagists proposed digesting foreign influences without denying the realities of contemporary Brazil and its rich cultural heritage.
Os produtos, as mídias, a especulação de produtos mesmo, marketing.
Marketing, speculation, advertising, all of that is really heavy here. It's a serious con game. It's pretty much the same as in the more advanced countries. We have 20 brands of powdered soap, 30, 40 brands of detergent, 200 kinds of canned sausage. We have all these things. The problem is that people can see them, but they can't buy them. So what do? They steal.
Zea's group occupied a building that had been abandoned in mid-construction to publicize the waste created by real estate speculation.
Quer dizer, eles desvalorizam lugar e valorizam outro a hora que eles bem entendem. Então,
the real estate speculators raise the value of one place and devalue another at the drop of a hat. So we began to work on this speculation. They tear down a place and create chaos, and we go to work on this chaos.
Em cima do caos a gente vai e trabalha sempre.
This space here, for example, is typical. They said it was going to be a cultural center. But in Brazil, nobody cares about cultural centers.
Centro cultural no Brasil não interessa para ninguém. E na época dessa construção, era governo muito complicado no Brasil.
The political situation in Brazil was very complicated when this construction was going on in the early 70s. There was a real witch hunt going on, and times were really difficult for people who were critical, you know, people who had anything to say.
Eu sou de uma família que veio pro Brasil com anarquismo.
I come from a family of Italian anarchists that immigrated to Brazil. I'm kind of anarchist. I don't know. I think things will become very chaotic. There will be total chaos. And then there will be a new society.
And what's the artist's role in this?
To help establish chaos. We have to be critical and work on this chaos. I myself work on the garbage, the ruins of the city, and that's somehow a way of elevating chaos.
Quer dizer, eu trabalho sobre quase que o lixo, os escombros da cidade, né? E isso de uma certa forma é elevar o caos, né?
Aqui não era nada disso, aqui era tão bacana, muita banana, muito espaço. Muito
aqui peixe. Mesmo?
É, era muito bacana, muito lindo isso aqui. Depois que chegou as indústrias, tudo se acabou. Não se achava mais nem um gato, nem um urubu aqui, morria tudo. E nascia muita criança quando você falia, morreu muita criança, morreu muito adulto.
A gente briga, é que sabe muita intriga, tanto amor do coração. Porque te amo, eu te venero, é para mim tudo, tudo que eu quero.
We always felt uncomfortable recording the pathetic signs of poverty that are everywhere in Brazil. The images are compelling, but they can easily become part of a voyeuristic display of faraway degradation, a cheap holiday in someone else's misery. We saw a different kind of street art in the Zona Leste, one of the major poor suburbs or periferias of Sao Paulo. Maria Egea was a fledgling women's theater group. The women had worked together in the movement of over 1,000 mothers' clubs that began to organize in the periferias in the mid-70s. These clubs were closely associated with liberation theology, a major force within the Brazilian Catholic Church that explicitly sides with the poor. We were taken to the performance by Moema, whose feminist group had supported Maria Gia and provided them with an artistic director.
Before I began to work in the women's movement, I was a teacher in the movement for popular education. For several years, I worked in the northeastern part of Brazil, in Maranhão and Bahia, which is a very poor part of the country. However, many of us who were doing this kind of popular education became targets of the military government. Many of my friends were put in jail, some of them killed, many of them had to go into exile. Finally, I too was forced to go into exile, mainly because I was involved in the movement to educate the oppressed, where we went in trying to train educators with the idea that we were the subjects of history, you know? It was very important to keep alive the idea that the people had to resist the dictatorship, that someday we had to win back our freedom and democracy.
When I was hired as art director, this group was already working on their play. I started with the notion of beauty and pleasure. Why is it that in Brazil, or in any third world country, low-income people deny themselves their right to pleasure and culture? Why do people feel so incapable? Why do they never think of themselves as artists? Because they were never permitted to enjoy art. Art is made by and for the elite. It was a dream all my life to do theater. I would see the theater, but I felt it was impossible for me. So when I got my chance, when I joined this group, it was really wonderful. It was like a dream come true. It may have come a little late in my life, you know, but I made it. Besides the theater, I work in the community, organizing to improve our neighborhoods, and we get together in our women's groups.
Always women? What about the men?
Oh, always women. Always women. The men are very difficult. Because the men's work is out there, you know, in the factories, that type of thing, and the women remain in the communities. And in this type of work, I think it's always women who are in the forefront, isn't it?
What was it like for you to do theater?
I really do think it was what I was looking for. When women decide to go out into the world, we're looking for something, some direction to go in. And the theater has been the right path for me.
What kind of path?
It's a way to do our work, to make a statement through the theater. Because in our plays, we talk about everything. We talk about the movement for land and for housing. We talk about women's liberation. We take everything in our lives and we put it up on the stage.
The play, spiced with puns and innuendo, was written by the women themselves. A young girl questions her bickering parents about sex, only to get evasive answers. She ends up a child prostitute, working for a pimp, and contracts venereal disease. Her peers take turns blaming society and her parents, while she dreams of moving far away. The women's movement in the periferias provided a major basis of community support for the Brazilian Workers' Party, the Partido dos Trabalhadores, or PT. It was founded in 1980 following a wave of strikes by industrial workers and brought together a wide range of social movements. The Workers' Party candidate for president, ex-steelworker Lula, narrowly lost the 1989 presidential elections. Our interest in the community roots of the Workers' Party led us to a gathering at Odechi's house. Odechi and her family moved to Sao Paulo from the countryside in the late 50s. She and her husband had managed to build a modest home with plumbing and electricity, though many of her fellow organizers lived on squatted lands in nearby favelas. She described to us her political feminist evolution, which began when she joined her local parish, a center of liberation theology.
Listen, folks, I was really one of those women that's just a sexual and domestic object. I served my husband, handed him his shoes, fed him. Then one day, Father Egidio came from the parish and said, I came to invite you and your husband to our meeting for married couples. So we went, and this first meeting was so important to me. I felt like everything they were talking about was meant for me. It was meant for my husband. All the things we were doing that were crushing our lives. For example, I always wanted him to come straight home from work. If he ever stopped at the bar to chat with a friend or play a round of pool, I would throw a fit. Same thing with me. I never went anywhere without him. He had to take me to the doctor, to go pay the bills. He did everything. I didn't know how to do anything. I only knew how to take care of the house. I was also very ignorant and crude about educating my children. I was ashamed to talk about sex, you know? I never knew how to answer their questions, and all that came out at these meetings. Then on the day of the last meeting, Father Egidio asked, well, folks, did you enjoy the meeting? I was the first to speak up. I'd never spoken up before, you know? I didn't really know how to speak up, but I said, this has been so important to me. It has changed my whole life. From now on, I want to participate in the community and be involved because I realized that was something that was really missing from my life. I had this problem that my husband forced me to choose either the church or him, the struggle or him. I said, I love you very much. I married you for love, but now you have to choose. I won't stop my work in the parish.
What happened? Did he leave?
He left, but he came back. There's no woman better for him than me.
É, e nós que reabrimos aqui no Brasil novamente o poder falar.
We women were the first to speak out again here in Brazil. Why did our movement begin in the church? Because it was the only space open to us, and often behind closed doors, because it was forbidden to discuss politics. Christ says, I came so that all will have life and live in plenty. And that's not happening, so it's not really the church. It's Christ's word that made us understand that our reality is wrong, that we have to help change things.
Odechi's friends took us on a tour of the favelas where they lived. Several had watched their children die of malnutrition and disease. We were used to associating religion with passivity and submissiveness, but on the contrary, Catholicism had served to move these women to action.
People ask me, Odete, do you really think things will ever change in Brazil? But I have faith. I don't think I'll live to see the changes I had hoped to see, but things will change. I have 5 grandchildren, and they've got to have a better life. It's just not possible that our children won't even have the right to drink milk.
Então, acho que o povo tem que se politizar, então tem que se juntar, tem que se organizar.
So I think the people have to become political. They have to get organized. But sometimes I wonder, you know, Caitlin, because I feel that the party doesn't value us as we should be valued. When the time comes for elections, we have no value. We're only valuable for campaign work, just to do the grunt work, you know? The people you met in the party sent you here because they know, that I participated from the beginning. I built things. I carried the stones. But when the time comes when we should all be together making decisions, we're not there. We're not even told about it.
Agora, este vídeo, quando você mandar...
Now this video, when you send it to us, I want to play it at a party convention because I really feel bitter that many times they don't give me the space to talk within the party.
We left São Paulo for the famous beaches of the state of Bahia and arrived in the capital, Salvador, as the city was gearing up for carnival. In colonial times, Salvador was a major entry point for Africans sold into slavery, and in the last decade, a black pride movement has grown up there. As outsiders, we could sense the often intangible presence of candomblé spirituality which seemed to permeate the city. Candomblé is an Afro-Brazilian religion devoted to a complicated family of gods, or orixás. It was persecuted throughout most of Brazilian history. The secrets of Candomblé are guarded and passed on by the Mais and Pais de Santo, priests and priestesses who undergo years of rigorous training. Like Haitian voodoo, Candomblé has incorporated many elements of Christianity, and devotees often consider themselves Catholics, despite the extremely different worldviews of the two religions. During the carnival season, Candomblé followers perform ritual cleansing ceremonies on the steps of the staid Catholic churches. We stayed in one of the oldest parts of town, the Pelourinho, meaning pillory, once the site of public torture and execution for rebellious slaves. During the day, the neighborhood is full of tourists sightseeing and buying souvenirs of exotic black culture. But from our view at the hotel, we caught glimpses of daily life behind the street facades, in the crumbling ruins that had once been slaves' quarters. Bahia, men can be seen performing capoeira. Capoeira performers gather at tourist spots to dance for money, a practice that the more traditional capoeira masters hold in disdain.
Capoeira de negro.
De negro? Por que de negro?
Oi. É africano.
É africano? Como é que é africano? O quê?
É muito importante.
Ah, por que é importante? A ver, fala.
Porque foi o negro que descobriu a capoeira.
Aham.
Pode defender.
Para defender contra quem?
Os negros botaram a capoeira no Brasil. A primeira capoeira que foi saída foi em Angola. Depois veio a regional.
Disguised as a dance, African slaves practiced capoeira as training for physical combat and resistance, preparing for the day they would run away to the quilombos. The quilombos were fugitive slave communities that existed for decades. We were told that some quilombos still exist, hidden in the interior of Brazil. Fashionable interest in Afro-Brazilian culture disguises a deeply ingrained racism in Brazilian society. The brutal economic reality is that the darker you are, the less you are likely to get. At our hotel in Salvador, we made friends with Eloisa, who worked in the dining room. We were shocked to find out about her situation.
Quantos dias de semana você trabalha?
É a semana, semana e semana, sem folgar. Sem tirar o domingo do mês e sem folgar o dia da semana.
E quanto eu pago?
A mulher, eu tô com o mês de novembro sem receber e dezembro.
Sem receber por 2 meses?
Sem receber, novembro e dezembro.
E por quê?
Porque a mulher tá apertada aqui no hotel, tá pagando as dívidas e não pôde pagar a gente.
When she did get paid, Eloisa was making the equivalent of $44 a month,
well under the minimum wage, which had just been raised from about $40 to $60 a month. By comparison, the hotel, one of the cheapest hotels in town because of its location, cost about $20 a day. Eloisa later told me that she had decided to ask the owner for the money owed her. I felt glad she recognized her rights and wanted to assert them, but I was also worried she might get fired and have nowhere to turn for support. Eloisa took us to her home to meet her four children in Liberdade, an old, mostly black working-class neighborhood. At her home, her husband immediately brought out the TV in a gesture of hospitality. The TV shows were warming up for Carnival. Bahia is a five-day cathartic explosion. Over a million people jam the streets and live out their fantasies. All semblance of normality and propriety is abandoned as people immerse themselves in sensuality and rhythm, swept along by a mob that stretches in every direction. In recent years, local rock bands have dominated the scene during the daytime. Parading through the streets on enormous trucks equipped with walls of amplifiers, they show off their latest tunes, initiating popular dance crazes like the lambada. The streets during Carnival have become more and more dangerous. After two attempted robberies, we constantly had to keep our guard up. In 1989, 40 people died and hundreds more were injured in assaults, despite heavy policing. At night, like many Brazilians, we opted for the safety of our hotel room and live TV coverage. We escaped the frenzy on the nearby island of Itaparica, a 20-minute ferry ride across the bay from Salvador. Itaparica is primarily a resort where wealthy Brazilians keep vacation homes. But hidden on the far side of the island, we discovered an old fishing village where men still use the traditional jangadas, boats that once could be seen all over coastal Brazil. The jangadas are gradually being replaced by commercial fishing boats that use large nets. These are far more efficient than the jangadas, but they are causing whole areas to be fished out, threatening the livelihood of the fishing communities. We felt as though we'd really gotten off the tourist track, but our visit to the timeless fishing village was rudely punctuated on our way out. We spotted a giant tent like a circus big top and drove up for a closer look. The tent was actually a traveling movie theater installed for the holiday season. Featured were an ancient Bruce Lee chop jockey and two porn films, one depicting the sexual adventures of a horse. In February, we set out from Belém, at the mouth of the Amazon River, to the town of Altamira on the Xingu River in the heart of what was once rainforest. Through a combination of bus and ferry rides, we made our way along the famous Trans-Amazonian Highway. 20 years earlier, the highway had been a symbol of hope and progress for poor homesteaders enticed by government promises of land and prosperity. The Amazon was virgin land, waiting to be made civilized and productive. The trip began smoothly enough. Then, as we approached the end of the paved section of the highway, night fell and the rains began, turning the dirt road into a nightmare of mud, the plague of deforested tropical areas. We spent half the night stuck several feet deep in mud. The tractors arrived to bail us out just as we were giving up hope of making it to Altamira in time. We were planning to attend the first national gathering of indigenous peoples of the Amazon. The gathering had been organized by the Kayapo Indians to protest the government's plan to build a series of hydroelectric dams near Altamira that would flood thousands of acres, much of it Indian land. We finally arrived at the Xingu River, the last hurdle before getting to Altamira. We ferried across and rode into town on the first day of the gathering. It was hard to believe this desolate cow town had been slated to become a thriving capital of an agricultural boom. Our host in Altamira was João de Castro, a poet from northeastern Brazil who had come to the Amazon as a popular educator in 1970. João was organizing community opposition to the dam and had provided local support for the Indian gathering. As he took us on a tour of the area, he gave us an account of the history he had witnessed there.
Sou nordestino, radicado aqui na Transamazônica. Cheguei aqui e comecei a viver o drama dos amazônicos. Nós estamos aqui em frente.
I was here on the 9th of October of 1970, when Emilio Garrastas do Medici, the president of Brazil at the time, came to unveil the plaque on that Brazil nut stump there, formally initiating the great historical feat of national integration, the Trans-Amazonian Highway. 2 years later, he was back, this time equipped with concrete, already neglecting the whole history of what is native to the area. He unveiled that other plaque, thereby officially delivering to the Brazilian people the link between North and South through the Trans-Amazonian. It was all very lovely at the time, when there was a little stretch here of about 5 kilometers that was paved, and the Brazilian TV cameras, that is to say, the government's own television, showed to all of Brazil that the Trans-Amazonian was paved. But the Trans-Amazonian you see today is in absolutely no condition to be shown out there as the highway of national integration. I mean, what kind of national integration is that? The thing is, they needed people to occupy this area, so there was this huge mobilization. And people came by bus, and the airplanes landed here. On some days, 5, 6, 7 airplanes would land here, sent by the government. And they dumped people here. They kept dumping them and dumping them. And they made it look like there was a whole network of assistance for these people, but there wasn't. So a guy would go out and start clearing the land, and a tree would fall and kill him. And his family would be helpless. That's how the Trans-Amazonian was constructed, with great violence. They went into Indian territory. They didn't even know there were Indians there, and the Indians died. And there was no respect for the environment. There was no planning on that level at all. In a project like this, the big ranchers always arrive later, once the party is over and the work is done. They arrive in time to have a drink. With the greatest of ease, they buy up plots of land from settlers who have no money. Then they convert them into huge cattle ranches. It's very amusing. They clear the land, they burn down huge areas of forest, and then they put 1, 2, 3 heads of cattle and call it a ranch. That way, they're entitled to financing from the Brazilian banks.
Junto aos bancos brasileiros. Como os bancos fazem o jogo destes fazendeiros, né? Destes capitalistas, é claro.
Since the banks just play the same game of these ranchers, these capitalists, of course they finance them. While the remaining small farmers along the Trans-Amazonian and along the side roads don't qualify for loans because they have no money to back them.
With the colonization fiasco, towns like Altamira swelled with failed pioneers. Now the government was planning to build the Cararao Dam, which would flood the low-lying neighborhoods where the poor had settled. Supporters of the dam believed it would bring desperately needed development to Altamira, but opponents warned that it would wreak ecological havoc and threaten the livelihood of Indians and other riverside dwellers, the Ribeirinhos, who lived along the banks of the Xingu. The Indian gathering, or encontro as it was called, had heightened controversy over the Cararao Dam. We wandered around the neighborhoods to be flooded by the dam and asked people what they thought.
O pessoal promete muitas coisas pra gente. Dizem que vão dar as coisas antes de fazer a barragem, né? Aí vão dar casa para todo mundo, dar abrigo para todo mundo, mas eles não dão nada, que não vai com os outros para fora.
É nossa toda a natureza, né? A nossa ecologia, toda uma vida será fatalmente destruída. Isso nós já temos experiência de tantas barragens já construídas nesse país, como Balbina, Tucuruí e outras mais aí.
Você mora por aqui?
Moro aqui nessa baixada e se essa desgraça vier a acontecer, nós seremos todos atingidos.
But the Indian protest had also mobilized the UDR, the Rural Democratic Union, which is the party of the large ranchers. The UDR is greatly feared for violent campaigns which have resulted in the murder of thousands of peasant leaders and grassroots organizers throughout Brazil. The local UDR leaders had planned a demonstration in support of the dam to coincide with the first day of the Indian gathering. The mood in town was tense as their trucks rumbled into town, filled with ranchers' laborers and their families. The night before, shots had been fired into the Indians' campsite just outside of town, and the road from the camp to town had been blockaded with trucks.
É porque vai sair, tá vindo a barragem, vem a energia, certo, vem o asfalto, porque vem o desenvolvimento pro lugar, né? Então vem também melhores condições de vida para a pessoa.
O índio é sem progresso.
O índio é sem progresso, o índio nunca passou uma roça.
Não dá renda.
Não dá renda.
Só como nós.
Só como as nossas custas, hein? Só como a nossa.
Nós estamos a favor do progresso. E não enfrentar uma dificuldade mais do que a que nós vemos enfrentando aqui.
Numa época dessa aqui que não tem estrada. Se sair a barragem aqui, sair a estrada.
The town officials made their allegiances clear by declaring a holiday and closing down the town so people could attend the demonstration. Despite the intimidation, the Indian meeting was packed with townspeople and outsiders who had come to witness this extraordinary gathering of Indians from throughout the Amazon. At times, it felt uncomfortably like a media circus, with TV cameras jockeying for position to capture the exotic show. One after another, Indian chiefs gave testimony to the decades of abuse, deceit, and genocidal practices their tribes had suffered as a result of government policies in the Amazon. Between sessions, the area outside the conference became a kind of public forum, with dam critics proposing alternative models of development for the Amazon. José Letzenberger is an agronomist from southern Brazil, recognized worldwide for advocating organic agriculture and radical economic change.
Dentro dessa visão, os tecnocratas, os empresários,
the technocrats, the entrepreneurs, the public administrators look at the earth and see only a bunch of resources to be exploited in the fastest possible way, in the most efficient way from their point of view, which means the most destructive. I see mountains demolished in Carajás to make aluminum cans or beer cans that end up in the garbage. It's totally absurd.
Isso é um absurdo total, não é? Hoje, o colono que está sentado na Amazônia
The people who have settled in the Amazon can only survive by continuing to destroy the forest, because the soils here are not suited to the kind of agriculture they're doing. But maybe we could help the people that are already settled on deforested lands to regain the fertility of the soil. But this needs to be done with agricultural methods that are biological, sustainable, without chemicals, with no big investments.
Com os métodos da agricultura biológica, regenerativa, sem química, sem grandes investimentos.
Daryl Posey is an American scientist who believes that traditional Indian methods also provide clues for new alternatives in the Amazon.
I have seen kayapo fields that stretch as far as 100 hectares. That's 225 acres. Those are very large fields. It's just that the kayapo are able to produce large fields, but they always maintain between the large fields natural corridors of forest. So there are ways we can actually do fairly large-scale agriculture, even mechanized agriculture, as long as we maintain corridors of natural forest that link all of these different areas that are under management, under development. Now, what we need to do, in my opinion, as a scientist who's been working in this area for 12 years, is what we need to do is to look at those systems which we know already work, which are hundreds of native systems, and we need to see how they've done it. How they manage soils, how they use their agriculture, what are the medicinal plants that are useful? What are the edible food products which we don't even know about in the city? As a scientist, I was concerned because it means that by moving these people from a place they're familiar with to a place very different, that this traditional knowledge which they've accumulated for many centuries will be lost as a result of that transfer.
There are people deep in the forest who know more than the white man, more than the men of NASA. The men of NASA know space, but in space there is no food. Now the Indian knows the earth, the forest. There's fish there. There are turtles and leaves and fruits that can nourish our bodies.
Marcos Terena, from the Terena tribe in southern Brazil, was an organizer of the conference, but he also doubled as a journalist covering the event.
The problem is that all over the world, Indians have been seen as savages. So if the Indian is a savage, he's good for nothing. Only the white men knew things. So then the Indian thought, we have to change the white man's head. So let's learn the white man's language, his customs. For example, that camera you're filming with, we'll film you too and use it to talk to the white man. So the Indian is changing, but he's not forgetting his language, his culture, and his customs. I can give an example that nature herself provides in the Amazon. We have two great rivers in the Amazon, a yellow river called the Rio Salimois and the black Rio Negro. They come together and travel together, but they do not mix. The yellow remains yellow, the black remains black.
This hopeful vision of future coexistence between whites and Indians was tempered by Indian Chief Raoni's statements on TV on the last day of the gathering. What did not make the TV news was the demonstration held that afternoon on the streets of the poor section of Altamira. Local organizers, students, and others who had been won over during the week called for a demonstration at the last minute. This time, there was no declared holiday, no trucks transporting people from out of town. All the major TV crews were absent, having been invited to take a tour of the dam site several miles outside of town.
Não pode continuar, a serra que eu tenho nada tendo nome.
pessoas conduziram o corpo de Chico Mendes da igreja de Xapuri, onde foi velado durante 3 dias.
On December 22, 1988, news came of the assassination of the rubbertapper Chico Mendes, the charismatic leader of the Rural Workers Union in the Amazonian state of Acre. Hired guns associated with the UDR had shot him to death in his home in the town of Xapuri. Chico Mendes was the latest victim in their campaign to defeat the rubbertappers, who were gaining worldwide recognition for their efforts to prevent deforestation in Acre. We arrived in Rio Branco, the state capital, a city dominated by ranching interests. The local ranch supply store had ample stocks of 2,4-D, a defoliant made in the USA by Dow Chemical and widely used in the ongoing assault on the Amazon forest. All along the bus ride to Xapuri, we could see the charred remains of the Brazil nut trees lamented in this song by Elio Melo, an old rubber tapper. Raimundo, the brother-in-law of Chico Mendes, took us out across the blistering heat of the pasture lands to his family's holdings.
This is the reason we're fighting, to stop our forests from being destroyed. Because we rubber tappers know how to protect our trees. They give us our daily bread.
Raimundo and his family tap for rubber and gather Brazil nuts in these remaining lush clumps of forest.
Many men were given a pittance for their land and they moved to the city with their families. They don't have any way to survive there. They turn to crime, become thieves. And that's why, for me, I don't have an education. I only know how to sign my name.
And if you had an education?
I still wouldn't leave because I'm used to the forest. The city's okay for a visit, but it's not for me. I don't intend to leave this place. When Chico died, I was really sad, and so was father. We were all grieving. But we decided that we should stay here and preserve what's ours. We've been in this place for 22 years, and we want to stay here.
Raimundo's father had managed to keep his home, although ranchers had come to him in the early 70s, armed with guns, with an offer to buy his land and hire him on as a ranch hand. It was in response to these kinds of threats that the rubber tappers, among them leaders Wilson Pinheiro and Chico Mendes, both of them since murdered, decided to organize themselves. They founded the Union of Rural Workers, the Sindicato dos Trabalhadores Rurais. When Chico Mendes was killed, he was replaced by Julio Barbosa, whom we met back in Altamira.
Quando foi fundado o primeiro sindicato no Acre, já a primeira tarefa era o empate.
When the union was founded in Acre, our first task was the blockade. When the ranchers' workers came to chop down trees on a rubber tapper's land, the rubber tappers would gather in groups of 100, 150 or so and go there peacefully, approach the peaos, the ones who go there with machetes to fell the trees are called peaos. The rubber tappers would say to them, "Listen, we want you to stop this deforestation. It's harmful to us. It's destroying our forests. And it harms you because one day you won't have any forest left to cut." But we realized we needed to have a higher goal. because if we spend 100, 200 years just trying to protect the forest so the rubber tappers could stay without gaining legal ownership, one day people would tire of this and it wouldn't work anymore.
The discussion led to a novel idea for agrarian reform in the Amazon, which was to set up extractive reserves, areas that would be set aside exclusively for the extraction of forest products. These forest lands could not be cleared, sold, or fenced off. They would be managed by the seringueiros who live and work there. The union has had some success in setting up these reserves, but Barbosa explains that the idea goes beyond mere preservation and management of the forest.
O que que falta pro seringueiro? Será que falta só a terra, só falta que a terra seja legalizada? Não é isso. O seringueiro.
What do the rubber tappers need? Just the legalization of land? No, it's not just that. Rubber tappers need schools. Rubber tappers need health care. Rubber tappers need to be able to buy goods at cheaper prices. Rubber tappers need to live without exploitation.
The rubber tappers have worked hard to construct their own network of social services and cooperatives, which they consider crucial to the organization of the forest reserves. They took us out to one of their community centers 20 miles outside of town.
This is one of our communities. It's called the community of Santa Luzia. Over there is one of our co-ops. It's for the producers of the area. And there's our pharmacy, and we have an examination room. Several of us took a 40-day training course in a health center and a hospital. Now we're under contract with the state, but it was a struggle we fought through the union, and it wasn't easy. I myself worked for a year and a half without earning a penny. We survived thanks to the compañeros who shared their harvest with us so that we could perform the services for the community.
On the 19th of December, 3 days before he died, Chico said, "The forest unites us in the face of a common danger and makes us more brotherly. And that is why I can't stop my work in defense of the Amazon forest, even if I must die." When he wrote this 3 days before he died, it's because he knew. Just to give you an idea, only 2 hours before he was murdered, he talked about his death.
Back in Rio Branco, where tens of thousands of displaced rubber tappers now live in shanty towns, the memory of Chico Mendes became a rallying point for supporters of his movement.
We've organized a public showing of video photography and news here in the center of Rio Branco to show people that the movement did not die. Chico Mendes was assassinated, but the movement continues. The bourgeois press and the people in power want to show that since Chico Mendes died, it's all over. But that's not the story. The population here, the poor people, they come to see our exhibit. They want to know what's going on. My idea, maybe it's a dream, but maybe it's through dreams that the struggle becomes real, is to create a great blockade on a national level. Who knows, maybe on an international level, and stand in front of the forest to prevent the ranchers from burning down the Amazon.
Shortly after we left Rio Branco, we returned to the United States. Although the international blockade did not happen, campaigns to save the rainforest were flourishing. But we couldn't help feeling ambivalent about campaigns from afar which appeal to romantic visions of pristine nature while ignoring the complexities of the human communities living in the Amazon region. For the people we met in the Amazon, the struggle against environmental devastation is also a struggle against poverty and powerlessness. Like so many others in Brazil who were trying to create a better life for themselves, they faced the entrenched structures of power and authority that dominate the country, even after the end of the dictatorship. What was inspiring about our tour through Brazil's points of resistance was the resourcefulness with which individuals, drawing on the diverse histories, spiritual traditions, political and cultural heritages of their communities, find ways to organize themselves and articulate their dreams for a better world.
nosso é nosso samba. Se é nosso samba, o samba é nosso. Pra que prisões dentro de ti? Sai, meu samba. Pois sei que tens claustrofobia. É tua noite, a noite, o dia. Vá se espalhar pelo país. Fatiga, estafa ou estresse. Não precisas de reza, quermesse. Passaporte, padre ou juiz. Já se abriu a janela do mundo. E agora não podes parar. Tu tens que conquistar. Tens que encantar e te fazer cantar.